Is it the case that any sufficiently advanced civilization destroys itself? Is that sort of a commonplace quality? I mean, that's the other potential answer to the Fermi paradox. Why aren't they here? Because by the time they got to the technological development where they could travel here, they blew themselves up. They destroyed themselves. And that's an unfortunate, but not a hard to imagine possibility based on things that have happened here on planet Earth.
We've discussed the Fermi paradox many times in our videos. The question whether there is life elsewhere in the universe is fundamental to our core, and our curiosity will never be satisfied until we have a definitive answer. While we may get starstruck when we look in the night sky and gaze in its seemingly endless sea of stars hosting countless Earth-like planets, and think we could not possibly be alone in the galaxy, physicist Enrico Fermi reminds us that we need evidence to infer the existence of aliens, hence his famous paradox. But what if there was actual physical evidence to suggest extraterrestrials are communicating with us? How would our worldview change if we found out aliens made contact? The Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, SETI, constantly monitors electromagnetic radiation for signs of transmissions from civilizations on other planets. Many radio frequencies penetrate Earth's atmosphere quite well, and this led to radio telescopes that investigate the cosmos using large radio antennas. These signals would be easy to recognize as artificial due to their repetitive nature and narrow bandwidths. If this is typical, one way of discovering an extraterrestrial civilization might be to detect artificial radio emissions from a location outside the solar system. On August 15, 1977, the Ohio State University's Big Ear radio telescope picked up a strong narrowband radio signal that appeared to come from the direction of the constellation Sagittarius and bore the expected hallmarks of extraterrestrial origin. It became known as the WOW signal after astronomer Jerry Ehrman discovered the anomaly a few days later while reviewing the recorded data, and was so impressed by the result that he circled on the computer printout the reading of the signal's intensity and wrote the comment, "Wow." The WOW signal remains the strongest candidate for an extraterrestrial radio transmission ever detected. However, only in the past 3 years, things have gotten quite interesting. BLC-1, which is short for Breakthrough Listen Candidate 1, was a candidate SETI radio signal detected and observed during April and May 2019 and first reported on December 2020, coincident with the direction of the solar system's closest star, Proxima Centauri.
Observation of a signal, a tight beam signal, very constrained within the frequency range within which the signal is vibrating, as well as the directionality in the sky. The signal seems to be coming from Proxima Centauri. That's the star, a couple stars closest to Sun, about 4 light years away. And Yuri Milner, who's been supporting research in science, physics, also search for extraterrestrial intelligence, has been supporting researchers to try to scour the sky and find signals of extraterrestrial intelligence. And, you know, when a signal like this pops up, the natural thought is, you know, maybe ET is out there. And it's always exciting. You know, whenever Proxima Centauri crops up in this guise, it can't help but capture my attention. I wrote a short story years ago about a boy who is on a mission to rendezvous with the first life that we have made contact with beyond life on planet Earth. And indeed, the signal is from Proxima Centauri. So it'd be kind of cool if that story were to have some basis in reality. But it's exciting at least that there's a signal that's anomalous.
Many papers have been written to explain the origin of BLC-1. A paper by some astronomers released 10 days before the news report about BLC-1 reports the detection of a bright, long-duration optical flare accompanied by a series of intense, coherent radio bursts from Proxima Centauri. However, it's very hard to know for certain these events are related. A study proposed that the chance of a radio-transmitting civilization emerging on the Sun's closest stellar neighbor was extremely small, so BLC-1 is very unlikely to be a technological radio signal from the Alpha Centauri system, but people still hold hope.
It brings to mind the possibility that it is some alien civilization that's sending out a signal to us. So these are the kinds of things that people threw around. But by carefully analyzing new data, Brian Metzger and his colleagues, they came to the conclusion that the fast radio burst is likely, at least in the case that was recently observed, due to a magnetar. These are neutron stars, which are, as we know, these very dense stars. They're not quite black holes, not at that level of compact object, but, you know, very, very dense objects. Sometimes these guys have very powerful magnetic fields, and that's where this name magnetar comes from. And at least in the case of the fast radio burst that was recently observed, the belief is that this object, this kind of an object, is the source. So it's not the end life of the black hole. It's not a snapping cosmic string. It's, again, not ET phoning us, but rather an exotic and very intriguing source of these radio signatures.
Of course, radio signals are not the only way we think aliens would communicate with us. Perhaps there is a way aliens communicate that we cannot even fathom. But that's neither here nor there, because in our perspective, there is no distinction between a civilization that is so advanced that we cannot detect and one that doesn't exist. And there lies the problem with the surge of recent UFO footage. If fuzzy video clips of unidentified flying objects, or as the US government likes to call them, unidentified aerial phenomenon, are the only piece of evidence to suggest aliens not only exist, but also visiting us, then we most certainly are nowhere near answering the question, are we alone? If we do not hear from aliens at all, that doesn't mean it's evidence for their absence, but maybe that means that we should be the ones that start exploring space and try to communicate with them. If our civilization survives and goes to reach the distant stars to find life elsewhere, our descendants will be the ones who will be called aliens. But who knows how far into the future that scenario lies, if at all. Our current fastest spacecraft, Parker Solar Probe, has reached a stunning 330,000 miles per hour, which, depending on what perspective, is extremely fast or extremely slow. If we want to reach distant alien worlds, we need better, more efficient ways for space travel. The Al-Kilbury warp drive is a speculative warp drive idea based on a solution of Einstein's field equations in general relativity. Theoretically, the drive works by creating a wave that would cause the fabric of space ahead of the spacecraft to contract and the space behind to expand. Although the metric is consistent with the Einstein field equations, construction of such a drive is not necessarily possible. Fortunately, it is not the only way for radically fast space travel.
So I think it's all quite exciting. And I think the idea is, you know, using solar sails that, you know, people have developed and, you know, trying to take that first step to Mars. I think that's a vital and valuable step to take. Build wormholes the way they did, say, in Interstellar to get to a different place, or trying to travel near the speed of light so that we would actually be able to traverse interstellar distances. I mean, without that, our colonization will happen in a very, very slow rate. But one of the beauties of relativity is if you do travel near the speed of light, you can actually go arbitrarily far in a human lifetime. People say, how's that possible? You can't go billions of light years. Well, you can actually, because as you go near the speed of light, the way in which space and time change allows you to go, in principle, arbitrarily far. So that's very exciting. But if we put that physics side of the issue and the manipulation of space and time to the side, you know, how do you terraform other planets? I mean, how do you go beyond our local neighborhood, say, without, you know, using the ideas of relativity? I mean, I think what we have long been, not always in the best way, is a species of explorers in the literal sense of traveling from one part of the world to another, or in the more metaphorical sense of trying to travel through our minds to the quantum realm or back to the Big Bang or to the center of black holes. So I think that's fundamentally part of the human spirit. So I do think that's a vital part of our heritage brought forward into its next incarnation. That's who we are.
With all our faults, as far as we know, we are the only hope for this corner of the galaxy to achieve interstellar travel. if we muster all our strength and work together instead of consistently scheming to destroy one another, we might yet see light at the end of the tunnel, or a wormhole, where a spacecraft full of our descendants appears, united in celebration, and starts exploring space. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.